Morning, brothers and sisters. How's everyone doing this morning? Well, good morning again. If you have your Bible, why don't you open them up to the Gospel of Matthew? We're going to continue in our verse-by-verse study of the Gospel of Matthew this morning. We have made our way to verse 11 in Matthew chapter 28. So I'll read for us, and you can follow along as I read in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 28. Starting at verse 11. Now while they were on their way, some of the guard came into the city and reported to the chief priest all that had happened. And when they had assembled with the elders and consulted together, they gave a large sum of money to the soldiers and said, "You are to say, 'His disciples came by night and stole him away while we were sleeping.' And if this should come to the governor's ear, we will win him over and keep you out of trouble." And they took the money and did as they had been instructed. And this story was widely spread among the Jews and is to this day. But the 11 disciples proceeded to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had designated. And when they saw him, they worshipped him. But some were doubtful. And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Would you pray with me one more time, brothers and sisters? Father, glorify your name, for this is why you have gone through spending the energy to speak all things into existence in order to bring glory and honor and esteem and exaltation and attention and reverence and respect and praise to you. And you alone are worthy to be made a big deal of, because you are a big deal. Father, as we sit under the teaching of your word this morning, would you help us to understand your will for us? Would you again impress upon us the reality of the truth of the gospel of the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus in such a way that our hearts are filled with gratitude and inclined towards obeying everything that you say is right and good and true. Father, if you please to do that, we will continue to strive to glorify your name. We ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, brothers and sisters, last time we were together, we took a second look at this account that Matthew provides for us of the resurrection of Jesus. And last time we just gleaned from that and extracted from that account of the record of the resurrection of Jesus, we took time to glean some implications and applications from the historic event of Jesus of Nazareth rising from the dead. Let me remind you briefly of the points that we took note of. That the resurrection is an essential element of the gospel message. You cannot declare the truth of the gospel, the good news, without referring to the resurrection, the physical bodily resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. We said that the resurrection proves the empirical, or provides the empirical proof of Jesus's identity. Jesus Christ claimed to be the unique Son of God. And he also predicted his death and his resurrection. And the fact that that actually historically took place provides for us the empirical proof that his claims were true. You know anybody else that predicted their death and resurrection? No. So Jesus, in doing that, and the power of God being what raised him from the dead, is the verification and validation that he is the unique Son of God who has paid for our sins. The resurrection, thirdly, serves as the verification of our payments of sins. Jesus, one of the claims that Jesus made is that he atones for sin. In his death is our payment for the sins that we committed, that God is no longer angry with us, that we are no longer the objects of God's wrath, because Jesus has paid it all. And his resurrection from the dead is the receipt and the proof of the transaction that took place in the heavenly realms. And fourthly, we took note of this, that the resurrection attests to Jesus as both Lord and Savior. And we stopped to say this, that because Jesus is resurrected from the dead, Jesus is Lord. And because Jesus is resurrected from the dead, Jesus is our Savior. But we connected the two and said that Jesus is not your Savior if he is not your Lord. If Jesus does not dictate, discern, and decide for you the decisions that you will make, you cannot call him Lord. For that is what it means for him to be your Lord. And if he is not your Lord, then there is no proof and no confirmation, and you should have no confidence that he is your Savior. For everyone of whom Jesus saved, he is also their Lord. Amen? And so now we look on, brothers and sisters, to see what happened following this return to the land of the living by our Lord Jesus. What happened after this extraordinary event following his crucifixion and his burial, where he was brought to life again by the power of God? Look with me again at verse 11 of Matthew chapter 28. Now, while they were on their way, who was on their way? The disciples, for Jesus and the angel had instructed them to gather together in Galilee, and that was going to be their rendezvous and meeting place. So the disciples were obedient to that, and they began to travel from Jerusalem to Galilee, where they were to meet the Lord Jesus. It says, while they were on their way, some of the guard, that is the Roman guards that were placed outside of the tomb, the Roman guard came into the city of Jerusalem, and reported to the chief priest all that had happened. Brothers and sisters, so we have eyewitnesses of the event. We have individuals who were there, who were struck down as though dead at the appearance, the supernatural appearance of an angel who removed the stone, Jesus coming out of the tomb alive and well. We have eyewitnesses, those who were there, who were impacted and affected physically by these events that took place, now going and reporting firsthand, primary source, eyewitness testimony to those who were responsible for putting Jesus on the cross. They go and they declare this message to those religious leaders. Now notice their response, brothers and sisters. Verse 12. And when they had assembled with the elders and consulted together, they gave a large sum of money to the soldiers. The last time they were divvying out money, they were up to no good, as they paid off Judas to help conspire to arrest Jesus. And so they give these soldiers money, right? Verse 13, and said, you are to say, his disciples came by night and stole him away while we were asleep. So they hear the report. Listen, just as the two Marys reported what they had experienced and what they saw, they reported that to the disciples. In the same way, these Roman guards reported to the religious leaders that Jesus was alive. And there are vastly different responses to the same report. With one, there was worship. And with the other, there was a conspiracy to suppress the truth that Jesus had actually risen from the dead. And so they conspired with this story and saying he did not physically rise from the dead. He actually was still dead, and his disciples, his followers, couldn't hold on to the reality that their hope was lost, and so they stole his body from the tomb and now want to perpetuate a lie, right? So this is what they say. Now look at what the text tells us after that. Verse 14, and if this should come to the governor's ears, we will win him over and keep you out of trouble. Now, this is important because normally under the Roman protocol, if a guard who is posted to protect or to guard or to take hold of a prisoner, if that prisoner escapes, the penalty for that for the Roman soldier is death. that they have to die because they did not do their job adequately enough. And so the religious leaders here are saying, hey, if word gets back to the Roman officials that this story where they came and stole his body, the very thing you were there to make sure didn't happen, if that is to take place and they find out about it, we'll put in a good word for you to make sure that you don't have to die because you didn't do what you were supposed to do. So these religious leaders go to whatever length necessary in order, listen, to suppress the truth about the reality of Jesus' resurrection. Then he goes on, and it says this in verse 15, and they took the money and did as they had been instructed, and this story was widely spread among the Jews, and is to this day. Now, brothers and sisters, I want you again to think about this. Matthew writes his gospel to a particularly Jewish audience, right? So there's no doubt that Matthew's account of the life of Jesus is being circulated in the city of Jerusalem, right? Now, there are people who have heard of this group of people who are these rogue Jews, these cult-like people who are following this Jewish guy who claimed to be the Messiah, who was killed, proving that he wasn't actually the Messiah. And now they're claiming he's alive again. But some of them have caught wind of the story that, they're claiming that he rose from the dead, but actually we heard that they actually just stole his body. So he didn't really rise again. And so now some in the believing faith and in the community of faith of those who are following Jesus, they're reading Matthew's account of the life of Jesus, his death and resurrection, and now they have included in the biography of Jesus the actual story of what really happened. Well, where'd this story come from that they stole his body? We believe that Jesus rose from the dead, but why are there some people who are saying that he didn't rise from the dead? But there was some conspiracy about some Christians who took his body away as a means of perpetuating a lie. Well, here you go. Matthew provides that to the readers of his day to say, this is what really happened. The Christians weren't lying. It was the Jewish religious leaders who were trying to cover up the truth of the reality of Jesus' resurrection. For me, brothers and sisters, it only undergirds my faith to see Matthew go to the lengths necessary to affirm these gospel truths in his day and age. Matthew's responding to what is happening in his day, as it says, and is to this day. This lie is being perpetuated among the Jewish people to this day. And you might run into some Jewish people that actually believe that lie themselves today, believe that Jesus never actually rose from the dead. And it's just interesting how Matthew includes that account there. But now, verse 16. But the 11 disciples proceeded to Galilee, to the mount which Jesus had designated. We don't know what mountain that is, but they knew what Jesus had said because in his preparation before his arrest, he had told them what must take place, that he would be arrested, that he would be crucified, that he would be buried, that he would raise from the dead, and that they would meet again. And so they go just as Jesus had instructed, just as the angel had instructed. Verse 17, and when they saw him, they worshiped him. When they saw him, they worshiped him. Brothers and sisters, just like in verse 9, when both Marys saw Jesus, they worshiped him. This was their response. And as we talked about there, this is not some reverence that you have for a king. They are ascribing to him the worship that is reserved for God. They bowed down, prostrate, at his feet, clinging to him and giving to him what belongs only to God. And his resurrection from the dead demanded that. And they worshiped him and esteemed Jesus here as Lord, as Christ, and as God. And brothers and sisters, as it says, but some were doubtful. When I read that, My first reaction as I read that is, why would Matthew put that in there? That's so inconvenient. Like, we're sitting here trying to convince people of the historical realities of the death and resurrection of Jesus, who then, in his resurrection from the dead, proves that we have forgiveness of sins, that he is God in the flesh who he claimed to be, but yet we have this inconvenient little clause there that says, as Jesus gathered with his disciples in Galilee, that some doubted. That's so inconvenient. Why would Matthew just leave that out, right? Here's why Matthew didn't leave it out. Because it's true. And because it actually happened. That there were those who doubted. Now, brothers and sisters, take note. The Greek word there, it doesn't mean a full-fledged denial or rejection of something as true. It simply means that they hesitated cautiously to follow suit with others who worshiped. And you know what that tells me? That tells me that you should not and you cannot truly worship that which you are not convinced of completely. And you shouldn't. And here we see that some were hesitant to worship Jesus. And the question is, why? Why were they hesitant to worship Jesus? Brothers and sisters, because it initially took time for them to process that they were witnessing a miracle. Just days later, they were trying to figure out how they will go on about their life after all of their hope, the eggs that they put in one basket, was lying dead, buried in a tomb. How are we going to move on? Jesus made so many promises to us. We watched him do miracles. He taught with authority like no other. Jesus healed in our presence. We saw him exercise the power of God at his command. And we really thought that he was going to be our Savior. We really believed and trusted that he was the Messiah. And now he's gone. And that one who they had spent a week processing, what am I going to do now? All my hope is gone. What is my life going to look like now? Now he's standing before them, and they're like, whoa. We saw from a distance Jesus being arrested. We saw him being scourged, and we saw from a distance Jesus being crucified and giving up his ghost. And now we see Jesus alive and well, walking before us. Brothers and sisters, would that not freak you out? It just would, right? You're like, whoa, I don't trust my own eyes. What is happening right here and right now, right? And that's what they were doing. We have recorded for us, actually, in the Gospel of John, that famous story of that one individual who has something attached to his reputation, which is not that delightful. In John chapter 20, we have the disciples running back, those who actually witnessed Jesus in the garden, resurrected in the tomb, in the area where his tomb was. They ran back and gave a report to the other disciples saying that Jesus is alive. And one of those disciples who did not witness Jesus's personal in person after his resurrection said, I don't believe that. I can't believe that. Listen, I'll believe it when I see it. When I can put my hands in his wounds, I'll believe what you're reporting. I'll believe your testimony. I'll believe what you're saying when I see it for myself. Who am I talking about? Thomas. Doubting Thomas. This is the account that we have for us here in John chapter 20, starting at verse 24. The scriptures tell us this. But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples were saying to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see his hands and the imprint of the nails, and put my fingers into the place of the nails, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." What is he demanding? Proof. There's different kinds of proof, brothers and sisters, right? In court, one kind of proof that is accepted in the court of law is primary source testimony. Witnesses, right? That was provided for him. It says, "We have seen the Lord." But he wants proof to a different degree of a different kind. He wants physical, empirical proof. You know what he's kind of saying? He's saying, I won't believe that unless I see the videotape. That's what he's saying. He's saying, I won't accept that to be true unless you can transport me back as a fly on the wall witnessing the crime take place.
That's what he's demanding. Now, the question is what he's demanding unreasonable? I need you to follow me. Is his demand for a certain kind of proof, is it unreasonable? Look at what happens. Verse 26 of John chapter 20. After 8 days, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas was with them. Jesus came, the doors having been shut, and stood in their midst and said, "Peace be with you."
So the door was locked, but Jesus just came right on in.
I'll leave that to your mind to wonder about. Peace be with you. Verse 27, then he, Jesus, said to Thomas, "Reach here with your finger and see my hand, and reach here your hand and put it into my side, and do not be unbelieving, but believing." Jesus says, stop doubting. This is the proof that you claim or you demand. Well, here it is. Here it is. Now, look at what happens after. Listen to the response, brothers and sisters. If you write in your Bible, you should take note of this. Thomas answered, when Thomas saw the resurrected Lord Jesus himself personally, this was his response. And he answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." Those are profound words. He didn't just confess that Jesus was Lord, his master, his ruler, his rabbi, his teacher, some person of honorable rapport before him that he'd be wise to live his life in submission to. He called him God, his creator, which ties all the way back to John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Thomas declares the confession of the deity of Jesus as Christ. And you know what Jesus doesn't do? Jesus doesn't do what all the disciples do who were given miraculous powers as apostles to perform miraculous signs and wonders. Jesus doesn't do what Peter and Paul do when they say, hey, get up. Whoa. Don't go worshiping me. You got to worship God alone, right? I'm just a man. Worship God, right? That's what Peter would say. That's what Paul would say. What does Jesus do? Jesus receives and accepts the worship of Thomas when he calls him both Lord and God. Now we see that he's following suit when those who saw Jesus worshiped him. Now Thomas gets on board, right? But the question I want to bring to your attention is, was Thomas's demand for a certain kind of evidence unreasonable? Look at what Jesus says in response to Thomas's worship. Jesus said to him, verse 29, "Because you have seen me, you have believed." Because you've seen me, you believe. Blessed are they who did not see and yet believed. Brothers and sisters, what is Jesus saying? That's a subtle rebuke to Thomas. That Thomas is demanding something, beyond the words of Jesus, who told his disciples that he would rise from the dead. Do you see what's happening here? Jesus rebukes Thomas for demanding more than Jesus' own words to him. God said it. I believe it. That settles it. Did you hear that, brothers and sisters? This is what Jesus meant when they asked him in Matthew 18, who's the greatest in the kingdom? Who will be the greatest? Am I going to be better than James? Am I going to be better than Matthew? Am I going to have a seat closer to the king's throne in the kingdom, Jesus? And he says, hold up. Hey, Riley, Johnny, come here. Unless you become like a little child, you won't even get into the kingdom, let alone be called great in the kingdom. Because like a child who humbly accepts that there are those greater than themselves, and just trusts with childlike faith, unless you do that, you won't even get into the kingdom, because the kingdom requires a childlike faith that says, there is a God and I am not him. And my job as a creature is to take God at his word that he calls me his child and that he's going to take care of everything on my behalf. Do you guys get that? I hope that you get that, because this is what we see here. And brothers and sisters, I just want to make a comment here in light of both Thomas's doubt and the hard-hearted unbelief of the Jewish people. We saw both in Thomas and in the Jewish religious leaders, we saw this this initial unwillingness to believe. But the Jewish religious leaders, theirs was a lot harder, right? And I want to stop and I want to say this to you, especially those of you who are wrestling with sharing your faith with others. I just want you to understand something, that unbelief starts with a disposition of the heart. There is a disposition of the heart that then filters information. It filters it, right? There is a difference between proof and persuasion. Do you get that? You can present to your friends the proofs, the empirical proof, the facts of the historical death and resurrection of Jesus of Nazareth. You can present those things to them, but there is a disposition of the heart that will either allow them to embrace those things with childlike faith, or to say, nah, I need more proof. Or to say simply, it doesn't matter how much proof you show me, I'm still going to set my course and be my own God. Do you hear that? Now, when you encounter people like that, what is our response? Our response is to recognize that God is sovereign over the souls of men. And though we beg and we plead because we love those people that God has placed in our life, that ultimately what we want for our friends and our family, what we want for our coworkers, what we want for those people with whom God has placed in our sphere of influence, what we want for our children, what we want for them is what only God can do for them. You didn't become a Christian because someone argued you into the kingdom of God. You didn't become a Christian because somebody forced you into the kingdom of God. You became a Christian because God's Spirit graciously softened your heart and opened your eyes to the reality of the Lordship of Jesus Christ. And you began to see the cross as something so precious and so beautiful that now you orient your entire life around the gospel. What you want for those people requires the Spirit of God regenerating a soul. That's it. And so with the same vigor that you are testifying to those people, which you should do, you should be pleading for their souls on a daily basis. You know, it's interesting. I was just talking to another pastor last night, and he was telling me about this, the life of George Mueller. And he said George Mueller, who was a Christian who lived a long time ago, and he prayed for his five friends who weren't saved. He prayed for them. And he said two of the five became Christians while he was alive. And he prayed for those friends, listen, for 56 years. And he died having only two of them become Christians. You know what? At his funeral, the other three became Christians. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It is not what you do, but you must recline yourself to the fact that it is a disposition of the heart for every individual that will either cause them to reject the truth that is plainly before them or to receive it and to be thankful for what Jesus has done. Do you guys hear that? It is a matter of the heart, and so we must pray that he who is sovereign over the hearts of men are pleased to bring them into the knowledge of his son Jesus and to receive it and embrace it. And so, brothers and sisters, I just want to encourage you with this. As Romans chapter 1 tells us that the wrath of God is being poured out on all mankind. Why? Because they are willfully, knowingly suppressing the truth in their unrighteousness. What that means is they are living lives of lawlessness and godlessness, and they are living as though they have no maker. And why is God allowing his wrath to be poured out on them? The scripture tells us in Romans chapter 1 that because they have sufficient evidence to know that they have a creator. That every person will be without excuse, right? It doesn't matter. What do we say? That ignorance is no excuse of the law. God says that they are not ignorant. that they have a knowledge of God, because God has given every human being that has consciousness, he has given them an awareness that they have a creator. And in order for them to go around saying, there is no God, or I'm agnostic and I don't know whether there's a God, in order for them to do that, they must actually be suppressing the truth and ignoring the evidence that is all around them that they have a maker. And so, brothers and sisters, I hear with that, I want you to hear the warning that the author of Hebrews gives concerning unbelief. Listen to this in Hebrews chapter 3. He gives a warning, especially to those who call themselves Christians, right? You might be at a place where you're doubting, or you're wrestling with your faith, wrestling with Christianity. Listen to these words of the author of Hebrews. He says in Hebrews chapter 3, verse 12, "Take care, brethren, that there not be any one of you with an evil, unbelieving heart that falls away from the living God." Did you hear that? That is a warning that you should be careful. Guard your heart and guard your faith and your confession of your faith. Verse 13, "But encourage one another day after day." You want to know why it's important to be in the house of God? You want to know why it's important to be in community? You want to know why it's important to be in fellowship, and why you shouldn't neglect it or make it something that's optional and not a priority for every believer? Here's why. Because we should be encouraging each other with the truths of the gospel, because Satan is preaching to you the exact opposite every day. Satan is seeking to cast doubt on the truths of Jesus, the words of Jesus, what the gospel tells us and teaches us. Satan is at every moment trying to speak lies to you and dissuade you from the truth. And if he gets you alone, away from community, away from fellowship, away from the encouragement of the saints, he can speak those lies to you. And you will become more susceptible to entertaining them, believing them, and allowing them to dictate how you live your life. The author of Hebrews gives us this warning, "But encourage one another day after day, as long as it is still called today, so that none of you will be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin." That's another reason we need to be in fellowship, so that we can confess our sins, so that we can be held accountable, so that we have brothers and sisters who undergird us, who are guardrails that keep us on that narrow path, who tell us things we don't want to hear, but that if we're truly saved, we ultimately do want to hear, because we know that it's truth, we embrace the truth, and as much as our sin, our flesh loves our sin, we need to leave it behind for that which is greater, the promises of God in Jesus Christ. Amen? That warning comes to those who are living in unbelief and doubt. So we see this response to them as they have gathered together in the name of Jesus here in Galilee. Verse 18, "And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, 'All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth.'" Brothers and sisters, what did Jesus just say? He is God. Or at the very least, he's saying that God has handed everything over to me.